Association from the players to the coach, and you saw something coming that was going to be a part of the reason that players got that feel of, you know, that's going to happen. It's hard for a unit to compete as such as a unit. I thought that was what was happening towards the end of the season, and when that happens, individuals become individuals, the team unit is not there anymore. With the season being pretty much over as it was anyway, and that just led to what happened in the offseason. Look at some of the stats from last year. They were scoring 93 points a game, 1.8 assist to turnover ratio. They were shooting 44% from the field and 36% from beyond the arc. Not very good stats for that game team. Probably why they finished 9th in the Southern Playoffs, not the Eastern Conference. But how bad was it last year? And how can we improve on that? Well, I mean, 34 wins, I think, is probably the biggest problem this year. In some ways, in terms of the future, they probably wouldn't be because they wouldn't turn the chance to talk very carefully. Yeah, you know, they had some issues that they're going to have this year. They'll probably rebounding was an issue, player shooting issues, free throws, particularly gets a big shot at the end of games. The personnel has changed, they're a lot younger, but they're probably going to have some of the same, issues this year.
And the key thing is that their one bright spot last year was Drew Holiday. Management, as I talked about, management chose to get rid of him and show that this is going to be a total rebuild. Now, someone might be like, if you end up with a kid who's only 21 years old and maybe an NBA all-star point guard, and they chose not to go out with veterans to gather draft picks and yards and a lot of stuff, and don't make the problem to the point. Last year, this just would seem like every player was playing up and out of position. You know, a guy who should have been a 2 was being a 3, a guy who should have been a number 3 star on the team, rather than a number 2 star on the team. And I think that led a lot into the 54 wins. Pretty much a new management. They brought in Stan Hickey as the GM of the Sixers. He spent 8 years with the Houston Rockets. He's new to look at the graphic. He was a strong believer in analytics. How do you think that kind of transition with this year's draft, and how's it going to lead this organization forward to kind of get out of the pits of that and fall for sure? Well, I think he's looking for winning players, if you will, which doesn't necessarily look at a lot of games this year. But guys who do little things, guys who are on team players, guys who run the floor, guys who, big guys who can run the floor, even if they don't see the ball for our 5 times. Michael Carter Williams was a very popular analytics people. He was available at number 11 and the Sixers grabbed him. It's a different approach. It's something that's just I've had some interest in, but certainly not to this degree. And it's a popular sort of new trend, and we'll see how it goes.
Such a contrast to what Doug Collins was about, when you would, I think Doug and I both agree, I think Doug Collins saw the writing on the wall, that was the move that they wanted to do, and Josh Harris has said some to that,
players are playing in best of those, whether or not you don't need numbers to tell you that. It's a new year right now. Tom and I grew up in a year where it was, I'd say, you guys grew up in an era where it is numbers driven as far as performances and stuff like that. So it is the new move, it is the new wave. Whether it works is yet to be seen, because there hasn't been many teams, maybe no teams, that have totally turned their program over at the Citrus Act and have put all their eggs in that league.
Yeah, I'm watching that last time, switching sports, it's baseball, the open baseball, and hey, do you guys feel like they're going to have that kind of success in the future, just with analytics, not like you said, getting a feel for players we have? Like, obviously, there's some scout players, but we'll have numbers on it.
I don't, there has to be a feel there, it's a little bit of what concerns me a little bit. If you're a Sixers fan, when I talk to Sam Hinkie, as much as you want to talk basketball players, which you can do, and he knows a lot about the game, a lot of times his project card gets back to numbers, and it's what this guy can be. He makes 60% of his shots from the right hand side of the field, and 24% of his left-handed shots from the left. And it gets crazy. And I just think if players are fair enough too much, and I mean, you disagree about that, if you feed players those numbers too much, they're out there thinking, maybe they're actually reacting in the basketball is reacting.
Regardless of what system you have, how you do it, be a star, you have a job, you have a chance to be a star, and you're not paying $24 million over the next 4 years, you know, it's a solid control, you don't know about the draft. But if you don't get a star by the finish, you're going to get a star in the draft this year. Whether it's Parker, whoever, Axel, whoever, you know, the top 10 players, if they don't get a star, it's really not going to matter. Because you're not listening necessarily to do things, the star economy, you can make money from trading to $2 million, like $15 million or whatever. But the halftime star doesn't matter what system you run, it's a matter of players. You might make the playoffs, but you're not going to consistently be a contender.
Right, and you mentioned that you're playing over everyone. Let's take a look at the graphic of the other one now. The Sixers of Coach Collins and Byron Q. Holiday, like you mentioned, and new coach Brett Brown in the 2013 draft acquisitions. Would be the first of the analytics class of sorts. Let's go right to the head coach, Brett Brown. You guys have been a player because obviously you've been writers for the Sixers. What do you think of him? How do you kind of interact with the team and do you like his style so far?
Yeah, it's kind of been a little tough for us because unlike other years where at the end of practice, especially in training camp, we would usually get about 4 to 5 minutes to watch the team and to see the coaches and work with the team. We're not allowed to do that this year. First real practice was today, and we didn't get a chance to see them, you know, work together in. So it's kind of hard in that aspect to see how he's getting along with Parks. Seems like a good guy, seems like he knows baseball. The one thing that sticks in my head, he really seems like he wants to go 100 miles an hour, and he's realized really quickly that he has a 25 mile an hour team. So he's going to have to try to hit the head on the road there somewhere.
Yeah, I don't know if you're talking about this earlier. He realized this was probably what was going to happen. But I mean, he's never not won 50 games in the NBA, and he was with the Spurs. So clearly, only 51 talent. So he knew this was going to happen, but still, when you get in the midst of it, and you can't go as fast as you need to do, and you have to stress fundamentals, you have to worry about players getting in shape, the things that you take for granted with the Spurs. That's clearly an adjustment, and he's in the middle of, kind of trying to figure all that out.
Yeah, there's a bunch of solid graphic, director of player development from 0207, and assistant coach, until he got hired by the Sixers. So much has been made of this Spurs culture down in San Antonio. How does it kind of break? Does it break any of that decision? Do you just kind of start over with his career? Is this his first like, coaching job and kind of get to do things like that?
Well, I mean, they had Parker, Sharpley, and Duncan, and when he got there, they had David Robinson. So, and those are guys that other players follow, they emulate because they're stars. Duncan's the MVP, and they won 4 championships and so on. So here, he doesn't really have the Evan Turner and Thad Young and Spencer Hall are not all-stars, they're not proven NBA guys. So he doesn't have maybe the advantage of having players that young players need to emulate based on what they've done. It's going to be quite an adjustment.
What interests me with him is that you talk player development, assistant coach, and Tom wrote up the three great players that you have there. When you're in that position, the problem is that I have a feeling that his job was to look past the communities, the Parkers, the Duncans, and look at the up-and-coming guys, the side guys, the guys that are going to get 3 pointers and make passes, play defense, and that. It's fine when you become an to change what you've been taught. He's been taught to what to monitor the side guys. If you want to say, you know, the number 5 through 10 guy. It's funny when you talk about practices constantly talking about guys, not the body shots, not the other turns, not the special calls, but the side guys. He needs, in my opinion, it's going to be an adjustment for him to get that focus on the stars of this team and get them to perform at their level and then have the other guys follow up.
If he doesn't really help make the most balance, the Lakers, those guys improve. But, yeah, Bob said, I mean, it's great to have complimentary guys, but you need to know that you need guys that can go to you need 15, 20 point game guys. It's unclear if this team has it, but he's responsible for everything. He would not have a number one assistant, he's going to take his number two assistant. So I'm going to use a coach, the Australian coach, to help the team. So this is a big jump. He's responsible for everything. And there's clearly a lot that needs to be done. Is that something you guys think he can turn on and kind of focus on the main players? Is that something that another coach is going to have to step up and do?
I think it's his job. I think it's his job. He talks about he's in charge of everything now. And especially the players who are going to lead this team. He has brought up that there's three guys, some special roles, everything. Those are the three that have to lead this team. That's how young this group is. That's how I know this group is. These guys are guys who put their time in the NBA. But it better matter with the big, you know, their experience is what these guys have over everybody else, and that's what he's going to have to look to.
Going with the youngness of the Sixers team, let's take a look at their draft pick kind of sadly gets prized. Move on draft night, which was crazy, I'm sure, for you guys. Out of Kentucky, let's take a look at the graphics. You only get 1 year there, 24 games, 7.5 points per game, knocks out of them. 4.4 blocks per game is more of a defensive stopper. How do you guys see them fitting to the Sixers culture? This team, obviously, you can't play for them, but do you see them being an active member of this team?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's clearly the plan. I don't think they're going to be a Russian back, because if you know the reason the Russian back, probably going to shoot around Duncan and Zillow today. He doesn't look that far away. That's not exploding, that's not him, he's not stopping and starting and things like that. But clearly this team needs, I mean, with Hollis and Claudia Shaw, you know, winning the Mirage and down the shot blockers, and nobody makes it, somebody thick on the kid down the lane, which they desperately need. And when he's going to get stronger, he's going to develop offensive game, but defensively, we're going to have him on, is what he brings the Sixers to really use.
Yeah, that's a good number. So you've got to be talking about pressure.
Once you look at it, he was surrounded by such good athletes at Kentucky, which they always had, which John Calipari is always going to get. Basically, he got his points off of jump lobs, quick backs, different things like that. Rarely were players run fairly well offensively. So is he going to come into the Sixers and when he's healthy and be at 15, 18 points per game? I don't think so. I really don't. I don't think these jump baskets come easily in the NBA, especially when you're running about 220 pounds and you're going to look against 270 pounders. He's going to get shoved around quite a bit. The other concern that I have is that with that knee getting healthy, they're trying to put weight on him, obviously. I mean, he was 2-6 at the combine. He says he's up to around 220 now. If you look at his leg, I don't know if you've got there, remember Todd Bixson, he's played for the Eagles, he had toothpick lines, and this is what this guy has. So he's going to build up his upper body. He's going to have a totally different watch to plan, have a different upper body, not a surgically repaired knee, a heavier body. So they have to be very, very careful about that. So, times like this, there's not going to be any rushing in back. People that I've talked to throughout the week wouldn't be surprised to start out the first season.
I hate to bring it up, but last season was filled with the Andrew Bynum experience and his needs, obviously. Is there concern that maybe Nerlens, with this new problem, is if you selected some guy with a new problem that just got off of getting rid of Andrew Bynum and the city was ecstatic when they did get rid of him, how much is that kind of concern such as things are you asking to?
It's funny that this ship was on the air and on the center, and you have to ask about his knee later on. But, you know, was it a chance worth taking? Probably. I mean, people have him as the consensus number one overall pick before this knee injury. And a lot of people still have him as the number one pick even after. So, a chance that he had to take, I don't know, I'm prone to having him all star, you know, point guard with the team, which was too hard. It remains to be seen. I don't think such a stranger who would be concerned about his knees. A young man, we'll see what happens with his knees anymore. They get healthy pretty quickly.
Like I said, I'm saying something here. I'm still alive in 2020. Still, I've had multiple surgeries on both knees, so he had some issues at least in my time before. I'm assuming right here he's on a lot more weight, you know, 290 pounds or so. So, there's no way to know.
obvious knee-jerk reaction, but it wouldn't seem at least at this point that there appear to be many similarities between the two. What grade would you guys give the Sixers draft on, specifically the Nolan trade, and the Ryan and Donovan?
Well, Tom, I need to get a question about you, Greg.
Well, it was interesting because initially, when they recruited it, they obviously recruited the Sixers for trading the first round pick along with John. So we could never pick because they only had one pick, and they still owe the pick to Orlando, and then Miami, you know, Montreal, and Montreal. So I couldn't understand what was going on with that. But he was very bold to change things quickly. Shaw surprised everyone, including the Sixers players. I'll say, like a B minus, but it could be higher or lower depending on what happens next year in the draft. That pick from the Hornets could be the sixth, besides the number six pick. But if they make the playoffs, it could be the 15th pick, or something like that. So a lot of it remains to be seen. And do they get with their own pick? Do they get the top three pick and get a potential star? I mean,
just on the back, they're giving the reins to this team to Michael Carter Williams right now. And a big point guard, 6'6", which is nice, but real thin. Weak, you know, not ready to face the radius of what that's going to entail. You have to win it out. Knowledge, however, might not know about for 2 or 3 years. I hardly want to see you know you have to and money, I understand, know about, but I don't know. I'm jury still out for me at this point. Let's take a look at what the government said. Just as they gave him the reins, Mike got so high, Syracuse. 40 games last year, 11.8 points per game, 7.3 assists per game, using the nation and assists for much of the year. Let us see in the final four. What do you guys see from him? And can he be that leader that the Sixers are looking for years to come? I find it hard to talk about the leadership of a guy that hasn't been playing regular season year in and year out. That position makes you be a leader, absolutely, on the court. Sometimes it looks different, sometimes you do it locally and by how they play. Sometimes just do it by how they play. But I see with him, Tom, and like you said, they didn't see him all that much. I don't know how vocal he is. He seems to be more of a strong guy in Orlando playing something. He seems to be more of an average shooter with his time. He's got some talent. He talked to a lot of people that he played against in college. His shooting is suspect. Sees the floor well, but he is big. There's positives in there that he's going to have to play out. He's still out on him. Yeah, I think the big thing with him, Syracuse, and even playing that kids for his own. They're going to run pick and rolls like crazy, putting him solid in the front downs. Physically, he's just going to wear down. They're going to put a lot of pressure on him, making him not running the ball up the court. And they're going to lose a lot. So there's a lot of mechanics. It's tough not to get beaten down, both physically and emotionally. If you're, 8-30 or something like that, honestly, they get put in the season or whatever. So I think he needs to, he kind of needs to keep down. He needs to stay healthy. Definitely work on his jumper, like Bobby said. And, it seems like he's trying to be more vocal, trying to point down some of the grades of Bobby, but unless he's going to be effective enough that they respect him to be a leader. As a rookie who engaged in here at Syracuse. And we saw with this draft, the Sixers kind of put other ends in one basket almost, trading Mike Romani. Let's take a look at the best and worst case. I got this from CBS Sports, the recruiting. Best and worst case for New Orleans. The best would be Mutombo, and the worst, Penny Hardaway. Mike Carter, Penny Hardaway, and Shannon Williams. Do you guys agree with that? Can you see either one of those guys playing any of those roles in the NBA? I've heard people compare Donald Miller to a former safety. A shot blocker, very good athlete, and again, a guy that got jump points in the game, that could do different things, rebound and things like that. But if you could get the kid that could come to the line, it's not a good sign up right away, but it's quite a good thing about this game, but it makes sense this game, but it makes a good game of anybody.
Yeah, I think it's all about 4 defensive players in the year, with 6 years and so on. He's, I agree with Bobby, he's more like Ralph, he's more of a side shot blocker because he goes for the face-up. The Tumbo was a face-up 7-1. The Blacker might do. He'll put right in line to figure. He'll come over from the other side, on the right side, and slip behind him. More of that kind of thing. Guys driving the back down the line.
That is quite a dichotomy there between, Tumbo and Rodgers is conceivable, but that is like the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. I think the big middle, somewhere in the big middle, a good solid player, whether he's going to be a star or else, I don't know about that.
All right, this is just possibly from the last video of Bob and Ken, but I'm going to take a look at it. It's together we build. Do you guys agree with this? And I said, all right, so disrespect to Jerry Lyman in terms of the shiny songs of the Bob and they've already declared this a building style. Obviously, it's a building style. You've never seen pro sports or franchise say that. The game up on this is not.
And, you know, and it's funny because when we talked about the first day, as long as we can play, we're here to help the young kids get better, which, like I said, back up to 25 million. But the thing that's going to be, and I'm writing this for tomorrow somewhat, is that these guys probably know that they're here for half the time. They're not the problem. They do know that they're here for half the time. So it's like a turn up playing to make the Sixers better, or it's like a turn up playing to make more money somewhere else. I would say they're probably going to stick with that. These guys are playing for other things in the building of the 76ers in the closing round. You know, the building of the roster really is going to be Carl Williams and the law. They love the guard for the next 2 years. I mean, that is right now the possibility. Just turn everything over. We know that is unusual. Where we do see teams, I hate to say rebuilding because the fans that we do are like the next one. Searching the team would never do it because I can't charge $1,000 if you sell for court set seats. And the Sixers, I think they realize that they know what they're getting into, and this is going to be a long process. Even if they get a star and they win this next year, I don't think they're going to be a playoff team in 2014-15. This is going to take a number of years. And that's a big reason why Brett Brown won the fourth year, because he knew the first year was going to be really difficult, and the chance the second year was going to be difficult too. And they can't hope that things play out for them. Like, everything has to go right for them for this turnaround to happen. They have to get the number one pick. They have to get the best free agents. They have to do what they're setting out to do. They can't settle for anything. Well, it can't fall out of their luck for things not to happen right. And they start their season on October 30th. Let's take a look at their upcoming schedule. They start the next one right in the fire. So it's all by again on October 30th. Then they have the Wizards twice more in the 5-game stretch. What's the best case scenario for their first 5 games? Honestly, they could start the season with 2 wins in 13 games or so. I mean, they're overmatched by the amount of who they play. If you really look at their schedule, they have Cleveland, they have the Bank of America, Chicago, Miami, like you said, Golden State. They have a bunch of playoff teams, good teams, and it's not going to be very good stuff.
Yeah, I mean, they fortunately got the next 1 year, but sitting on a lock the night before another team up playing overseas and flying. So that's something maybe they can take advantage of. But by the same token, they would watch in reverse too. They'd go be playing a first game and fly back to the room somewhere, and some people can sit knocking around for 2 days. So again, it's going to be very difficult, for them to string put together the kind of a winning streak, really sort of gain any momentum. It's going to be more about individuals and more about how they plan for whether or not they are for their futures. There's so many guys on the last year of contracts or can be on last year of contracts or partial guarantees or whatever a lot of these young guys. So, there's things to play for, but as Bob said, it's not necessarily the future of the Sixers. Now, we're going to best case, worst case wins for the year, I guess.
Well, I'll just give it my name to mine. I think they're going somewhere around 18 games.
Yeah, I said like 21-4. That might be a little optimistic. The worst thing I can tell you, John Hughes was the coach of 95-96, they won 18. That's the worst record that I've covered. And I would say that, it's certainly possible that they could threaten that, if not eclipse it. If things don't find their way, or guys don't progress, or they have an injury to a key player, like there aren't a whole lot of, like a Turner or somebody like that. If they don't trade him in February, they might go to somebody like that, Kane, somebody like that. There's so many things that could be, and they don't have any money to get them into next summer.
So you didn't cover the balance of the 3-2-5?
I did not, but I started covering it. I started covering it in the hours, so there's a good business for me. I want to do a fast five segment here at SportsTalk Philadelphia. First, just favorite Sixers memory about covering the team.
to the Chiefs, right? We see like Dallas actually retired and played against the Denver Nuggets. It was a terrible, terrible season, but for that night, it was pretty electric.
So, favorite player to cover as a bonus certificate?
Well, we were talking about Berkeley, who actually was in about these last 4 years, in the fourth year, and kind of contributed to us, so it's a little different. But it's not fun, it's a totally different era. The locker rooms were open. You could watch practice, you know, he would talk to you, you know, when he played, he talked about sports and politics and whatever. So I'll say Berkeley.
All right.
I'm under 10 seconds at the last 5 years I'm this year.
Why did you want to
play? I'll say over under is 4.
Okay.
Tom, how many years until the Sixers make a finals appearance? I would say, you know, at least 4.
All right, last question, Mr. Bonfield.
Just the salary, we're all journalism managers here, mass media. When do you guys know journalism? And
when did you know journalism?
How long did you do journalism?
Since I was a little kid, I knew that if I couldn't be a professional, I think I certainly wanted to write about them. I mean, right off the bat, my father was a newspaper man, so I knew that they were very young.
Yeah, my dad was a part-time sports writer here in high school. He was a bunch of them on the ground. He was a time for me, and the same thing. 6 or 7.
All right, well, that'll do it for us here at SportsTalk Philadelphia. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please feel free to reach us. LaSalleTV.edu, or also on the internet, LaSalleTV.com/LaSalleTV. We also have social media. We are on Twitter, @DeAndreAlbert1. We also have Facebook. You can search SportsTalk Philadelphia, as well as YouTube. Keyword search SportsTalk Philadelphia. Bob and Tom, thank you guys very much for coming on the show. We really appreciate it. That'll do it for this week's edition of SportsTalk Philadelphia. We'll see you next week.